Good morning, everybody. And welcome to worship. As you enter and we're getting everybody settled in, if you are able, let's stand together and let's sing our first hymn, which you can find in your pew songbook, The White Binder. It is on number 33, Morning Has Broken. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning. Praise for them springing fresh from the word. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God's feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one night Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation. You may be seated.
Good morning and happy Sunday. It is good to see you all today. This is what we're aiming at right now is once a month. Special joint service of the Congregational Church of Fullerton and the Brea Congregational Church. And so I see faces from both congregations over here today, and that's wonderful. Because in the UCC, we like to say, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And today is I think, a great day to be here. There was Vacation Faith School here all week, and there's kids here this morning, and I love hearing the sounds of kids, especially when they're not my kids, in the worship service. My kids' noises stress me out, but your kids' noises are super welcome. In September, we are working on a date, but we are going to have another joint event of our two congregations, a special Taco Truck Sunday. I'm very excited. Stay tuned so you have the date and you can be here for a fellowship time and tacos. I hear Jack is back.
Yay, Jack!
Yay, Jack. Good to have you back. One of the traditions of the Congregational Church of Fullerton is that every Sunday we ask if there are any birthdays, anniversaries, or other celebrations. And if it is your birthday today, that is extra special. I think we have one of those today. But if this is just like the closest date that you have been to church to your birthday, we will sing to you today. So, let me know whose birthday, anniversary, other celebrations. Yeah? It's your birthday! How old are you? Nine! That's a great number. Morrison, you're seven? Oh my gosh, how's that possible? All right, so we've got Karis, did I say that right? Karis and Morrison. Any others? All right, let's sing.
Happy birthday to you, Karis and Morrison. Happy birthday.
And so now we'll join together in worship with our gathering music.
You'll find the gathering music also in that white pew songbook. It is number 37, One Earth, One Sky. If you're able, let us stand together and sing the first verse together. One earth, one sky, one God on high, one people here below. One binding theme, one goal, one dream for all who live and grow. Peace on earth, peace on earth, Shanti Salam, Shalom. Shalom. Peace on earth, peace on earth, Shanti Salam, Shalom. Peace on earth, peace on earth, Shanti Salam, Shalom. You may be seated.
Good morning. I'm Karen Hill, and I will be your liturgist this morning. Please join me for our call to worship. We are called to praise and prayer, to song and silence. God calls us to worship. We are called to hearing and healing, to service and solidarity. God calls us to love. We are called to advocacy and action, to protest and provision. God calls us to justice. Let us heed God's call. Let us worship together with joy.
Hello. Many of you may know this song already. It is from one of my favorite musicals I watched when I was a little kid, written by Oscar Hammerstein and Richard Rodgers. The King and I, from The King and I, Getting to Know You. There are many people in here that I'm still getting to know. And I am really shy and bad with names, so I appreciate everyone always saying hello and helping to get names in my head and just getting to know everyone. It's a very ancient saying, but a true and honest thought, that if you become a teacher, by your pupils you'll be taught. As a teacher I've been learning, you'll forgive me if I boast. I've now become an expert on the subject I like most. Getting to know you. Getting to know you. Getting to know all about you. Getting to like you. Getting to hope you like me. Getting to know you, putting it my way, but nicely. You are precisely my cup of tea. Getting to know you, getting to feel free and easy. When I am with you, getting to know what you say. Haven't you noticed? Suddenly I'm bright and breezy because of all the beautiful and new things I'm learning about you day by day. Getting to know you, getting to know all about you, getting to like you, getting to hope you like me. Getting to know you, putting it my way, but nicely. You are precisely my cup of tea. Getting to know you, getting to feel free and easy. When I am with you, getting to know what you say. Haven't you noticed? Suddenly I'm bright and breezy because of all the beautiful and new things I'm learning about you day by day.
Thank you, Jessica. Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4, verses 18 through 22. As Jesus was walking along the Sea of Galilee, he watched two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, casting a net into the sea. They fished by trade. Jesus said to them, "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of humankind." They immediately abandoned their nets and began to follow Jesus. Jesus walked along further and caught sight of a second pair of brothers, James and John, then Zebedee. They too were in their boat, mending their nets with their father. Jesus called them, and immediately they abandoned both boat and father to follow him.
I invite all of our young people to come forward. Come on down, my friends. Good morning, everyone. How are you doing today? Good. It's good to see all of you. You might notice some of our friends have our tie-dyed shirts on. We had Vacation Faith School this past week, and we had a great time. We were learning a lot of stuff and spending time together, right? Pretty good time. I have a question. Good morning. I have a question for you. Have you ever met a stranger? Yeah? Have you met a stranger? Yeah? You might be sitting with some strangers this morning, huh? Have you guys met each other? It might be your first time meeting each other, right? What do you know about strangers? Sometimes they're nice, and sometimes they're not. That's probably really good advice. I don't want to get anyone in trouble in here, so I'm going to be very careful with how we talk about strangers, because you probably have rules in your home about how you're supposed to interact with strangers. But when you do so in a safe way, right, with your parents around or in a safe place, it can be really fun to meet new people. What do you feel when you meet a new person? Do you feel excited? Yeah? Do you ever feel a little nervous? Maybe you meet a new friend at school and you're trying to feel them out. You don't know what they're like. Maybe you ask them some questions. You go and make friends with them? That's so nice. That is a really good way to be. So when we meet new people, we can ask questions about what they like or don't like, and that's a way we can get to know them, right? And if we spend more time with them, pretty soon what? Are they strangers anymore? No, they're friends. That's pretty cool how that happens. And sometimes we have to remember that we actually met every single person that we come across for the first time at one point, right? Even if we feel like we've known them forever. So this morning, we're going to all stand up. And we're going to spread out a little bit. Don't go too far. That's probably pretty good, huh? And we're going to think about something. How do you think you might connect with some of your friends here? Or strangers, whichever one they might be. You have any ideas? Maybe you could give a little wave. Wow. Are we awake? You give a little wave, or you could say, "Good morning." Good morning. No, all right. I thought of another way that we might be able to be connected. So we're going to use this rope, twine, I guess, and we're going to see if we can connect to one another, okay? Paul, can you grab onto the rope? Thank you. And Saxon, grab on. Grab onto the rope. Awesome, awesome. So glad we have a long enough rope. So Noelle, I have a question for you. Are you standing near Paul? Where's Paul? He's way over there, huh? You could probably wave to him. You could definitely see him over there. Hi, Paul. But you're not standing next to him. But look, look at how you're connected, right? If you follow the twine all the way through, it gets to him, right? That's pretty cool. So even though you're really far away from one another, you're connected by something. So I want you all to think about this. Maybe if you were in preschool once or you're in preschool now, you remember grabbing onto that rope. Did you ever do that in school? I did, where you had to grab onto the rope so that you didn't lose your class or you didn't lose your friends, and you had that thing to grab onto to remind you of where you're supposed to be and who you're supposed to be with. So this week, yeah, you remember that? Oh, the first day of first grade? Yeah, you had to grab onto the rope so you knew where you're supposed to be at all times, right? So this week, as you meet new people, I think a lot of you are starting school, right? This is your first week of school. I want you to think about this rope, this twine. And you may not have a physical rope. You may not have an actual rope in your hand. Some of you may. But you can think about this rope and the fact that God and our faith connects us to every single other person, even if you're this far away, right? We have something that weaves between us and connects us to everyone around us, which is pretty cool. Shall we have a prayer? Yeah? Wow, ringing endorsement. Let's have a prayer. Dear God, as we go into new situations and as we meet new people, we ask that you remind us that we are connected to them because of you, that you are in us and among us, and you fill among us, yes, and you fill the spaces between us. And you remind us that we are all connected through your love. Amen. Let's go to Sunday school, my friends. Have a good time. Oh, that's so cool.
For those who don't know, Among Us is a game.
Bye, Paul.
All right. And we'll wave to our friends as they leave and stand and sing our next hymn, which you can find in your pew hymnal, the hymnal number 391, In the Midst of New Dimensions. In the midst of new dimensions, in the face of changing ways, who will lead the pilgrim peoples wandering in their separate ways? God,
sorry,
God of rainbow, fiery pillar, leading where the eagles soar. We, your people, as the journey now and ever, now and ever, now and flood of starving people, warring factions and despair. Who will lift the olive branches? Who will light the flame of care? God of rainbow, fiery pillar, leading where the eagles soar. We are people, the journey now and ever, now and evermore. As we stand, a world divided by our own self-seeking schemes, grant that we, your global village, might envision
do have one more quick announcement before we get into our sermon time, and that is that the Brea congregation is participating in the Mission Dash through our UCC Global Ministries, and we invite our Fullerton friends to join us as well. It's a 5K, but don't worry, you don't have to do it all at the same time. And it's going to benefit Creation Justice Ministries, working against climate change, and we're going to come up with a bunch of ways for us to get in our 5K together. So if that's walking from your car to the church, that's great. If that's walking through the aisles of the grocery store, it all adds up. And we're going to do a group neighborhood stroll next Sunday before worship at 9 a.m. So you can meet in the parking lot, and we'll just take a little stroll and try and get some of our, I was going to say kilometers, but our miles in toward our 5K. And it should be a great way to do that. And you can sign up online. You can see Christy. Give a big wave, Christy, if you have any questions or if you want to sign up for that. And we'll be walking together. So thanks. This week, I had the immense pleasure of spending time with seven of our young people, ranging in age from 6 to 10 years old. Our Vacation Faith School, which is a spin on the traditional Vacation Bible School, but focused less on biblical literacy, although that is a component, and more on creating an environment where kids will want to develop a faithful life through community, art, music, and a little fun. It was a beautiful experience. In fact, I think as a facilitator, my own faith was deepened as our kiddos asked questions, thought about how they might affect the world around them, got a little messy, and created the community we all so desperately need and come to church to seek out. There are so many stories from this past week, and many thanks to be given, especially to all of you folks from both congregations who donated supplies and prayed for our young people as we gathered each day. And I hope over the coming weeks, I can share a little of the magic that happened over the last week. But for now, I'll share a couple of highlights. On our last day together, we worked on a group art project. Our theme was making waves, so we used finger paints to create a beach scene. The kiddos used their hands and their feet with the paint as we created art together. And hysterics ensued as I attempted to give each of them a piggyback ride into the shower area to wash off their feet. If you see any remnants in the hall, we did our best to clean up, but don't worry, it's washable paint. As Aiden and I painted their hands with the finger paint so they could use their handprints to create the ocean, one kid exclaimed, "This is one of the best days of my life." And I had to agree. As the week came to a close, all tired and full from snacks, covered with paint, and our Sunday school room a total mess, one of the kiddos asked another's mom for her phone number so the two kids could stay in touch when the week was over. And this was perhaps the biggest accomplishment, so to speak, of our time together. Kids who had previously been strangers, now linked with shared memories and experiences that will reverberate for years to come as they ask one another, "Remember that one time at Vacation Faith School?" In talking with a friend earlier this week, I had this realization that church is one of the only places where we get this multi-generational community. A place where you can have a 96-year-old friend and a 2-year-old friend and get to see them together both on the same day, creating memories that make strangers friends and fellow congregants family. There are so many times throughout our lives when we come across strangers and times when those strangers have the potential to become major players in our lives. Maybe you can think of those strangers you've encountered over the years at church, at work, in your neighborhoods. For me, those experiences have often come through traveling, people I've met by chance on a train or in a restaurant, but who have continued to be fixtures in my life, reminding me that, well, for any of our relationships, we met people for the first time once. even if it feels like we've known them forever. In thinking about the power of strangers who become friends, I think of one particular travel story. It's not my own, but it's a story by Laura Zimmerman. Laura and her husband, both American by birth and culture, spent some time traveling in Portugal 25 years ago. This was, of course, long before GPS and maps on smartphones, so they spent their time looking at real paper maps. And for anyone over the age of probably 25, you well know that paper maps only work if you know where you currently are. And so throughout the week, they relied on the help of others, asking in their broken Portuguese how to find interesting destinations, bathrooms, and food. Although due to their limited language skills, they could only ask for plain ham and cheese sandwiches. On their last day in Portugal, they decided to go out for a hike, and having been warned about pickpocketers, they put their passports and their airline tickets, their money, and a bottle of wine that they wanted to take home in a blue backpack in the locked trunk of their rental car. And they returned from their hike. They were dismayed to find the trunk open and the backpack, which turned out to be the perfect vehicle for someone to carry their belongings in, was stolen. And of course, the missing passports was one thing, although they figured they might be able to contact the embassy for help. But the stolen plane tickets were another. 25 years ago, there was no such thing as a virtual ticket. Airlines instead issued paper tickets and were not the most forgiving if you lost them. And so they began trying to contact the airline, and after trying and trying the phone number, they realized it was a Portuguese holiday and the airline was closed. Desperate for some sort of direction, they called the police, who told them to go to the airport in the morning and see if someone could help them. And oh, by the way, they probably won't. So Laura and her husband went to sleep tossing and turning, fearing that they would be unable to get home. They arrived to the airport, bleary-eyed and desperate to get on a plane. They approached the ticket counter and began to tell the story. "We were robbed. We have no passports or tickets or wine. And oh, by the way, we've been eating ham and cheese sandwiches for days. Can you please help us?" Before they could finish their plea, the woman at the ticket counter said, "We have your tickets." Laura and her husband looked at each other and incredulously asked, "How? They were stolen over 2 hours south or east of here." The woman got on her radio, and soon a big man in a suit with an airport badge on was approaching them with a blue backpack in hand. And he began to tell them the story. The day before, in honor of the holiday, a woman, Maria Teresa Cavalho, had gone mushroom hunting in the national forest, not far from where they had been hiking. Deep in the woods, she found the blue backpack discarded. The wine and the money were gone, but the passports and the tickets remained. And as Maria pulled out the contents, she realized that the tickets were for the following morning. And so she called the airline, but because of the holiday, there was no answer. And so instead of giving up, she tried the American embassy. They too were closed because of the holiday, but she was able to find an emergency number, which was probably for real emergencies, not lost plane tickets, but Maria was persistent. She somehow talked the embassy operator into tracking down the home address of the airport director. And so at 2 o'clock in the morning, this Portuguese mushroom forager drove the tickets and the passports to his home. Laura started crying at the word mushroom and continued to sob all the way across the Pacific or the Atlantic or whatever that big ocean is. And when she arrived home, she had a hard time coming up with what to do to thank Maria Teresa. So of course, she sent wild rice and Mall of America magnets and had a phone conversation with Maria Teresa's broken English, getting them through, where she profusely thanked Maria for the impact she had on her life in this singular act of kindness. Maria Teresa's response, "Sorry, I couldn't find the wine too." How often do we think of the people in our scriptural stories as strangers? The people in our Bible have become so familiar that we don't think of them as being strangers in the beginning. People who crossed one another's paths to make a lasting impact. In many of the healing stories, in many of the stories where Jesus is teaching the crowds, he is interacting with people who may have heard of him, but who he does not know intimately. Of course, as his ministry continues, as community expands, the number of strangers dwindles. But in the early days, we aren't dealing with people who have long-standing relationships. And so if Jesus' goal as he is starting his public ministry is to change the system, to create change that extends far beyond his own family and his own friends, he's going to have to rely on relationships with strangers, or at the very least, people he doesn't know well. As we hear our passage from Matthew, as Jesus begins the networking with others, he walks along the seaside. He doesn't recruit from royalty or the upper crust. No, he connects with ordinary people, strangers perhaps, to build his network. Raj Nadella, professor of New Testament at Columbia, says, Jesus moves quickly to invite the first set of disciples to join him with the promise of making them fishers for humankind. The phrase connotes challenging structures of power. It is a transformative and dangerous mission that Jesus invites the disciples into. And they leave their families, their livelihoods, and they instantly join him for little in return. Disciples were apparently inspired by the mission and made radical commitments to the movement. The Roman Empire relied on threat, coercion, and enticements to recruit people into its military. The New Kingdom, on the other hand, inspires them to participate in it. Nadella reminds us that Jesus is doing something new. Instead of seeing strangers as assets to an army, Jesus sees strangers as a network of hospitality and change and support and growth. Jesus sees them as disciples, as companions on the journey, as people who he will work with to make sustainable transformation. Nadella continues, the mission was passed on from John to Jesus, to the disciples, and eventually to Matthew's community, and it has been passed on to us. As the church, we are invited to partake in the transformative work of the new kingdom, but we also have the task of inspiring others to join the movement too. The Jesus story, and particularly the selection of the disciples, reminds us that our shared humanity, our connection with the divine, it will all overcome any notion of strangerdom and instead transform us into thriving and connected community. So whether you met strangers at a week of vacation faith school and became connected for years to come, or you encounter a mushroom forager in another country who's willing to give time and energy, even in the middle of the night, to make sure you make it home safely, or you worship with folks from a different congregation, starting off as strangers, but quickly realizing that we are one in God's kingdom. May you be blessed in the same way those early disciples were, called to do something bigger than themselves and finding the holy in the midst of the unknown. May it be so. Amen, and blessed be. And now I invite you to spend a few moments in silence.
But do not be afraid. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. In the Lord I'll be ever thankful. In the Lord I will rejoice. Look to God, do not be afraid. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. In the Lord I'll be ever thankful. In the Lord I will rejoice. Look to God, do not be afraid. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. In the Lord I'll be ever thankful. In the Lord I will rejoice. Look to God, do not be afraid. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near.
Let us pray. Gracious God, in the debris and litter of the world, you clear a place where we can be planted in your justice, which can bring hope to the oppressed, and your righteousness, which can receive even our enemies in peace. Plant within us your grace, your love, fierce hope, enduring faith, that we might follow where you call us, to bring wholeness and peace to the world's brokenness, and to bear witness to your divine image throughout creation. Give us the courage to follow you together. Holy One, bringer of peace, we grieve the war and violence of the world, and we hold our grief to you as prayer. For the ongoing war Russia has perpetrated in Ukraine, inflicting untold trauma on children. For the assaults from Israel in the Rafah refugee camp in Palestine, where over 300 were wounded and 4 women and 15 children were killed. For the threats of military action from China against Taiwan. For the displaced millions in Afghanistan who live in abject poverty due to decades of war and the oppressive government of the Taliban. And for Sri Lanka, where the government is using extreme force against those peacefully protesting over severe economic crisis there. Draw near, holy love, enfold us, and heal our wounded world. Holy One, giver of truth, we have failed to care tenderly for your beloved creation. So we hold to you in prayer the places we see being broken by climate change. For the wildfires in California and in the Duran region of France, for thousands evacuated from their homes, and the drought and extreme heat in Europe, with one of the hottest summers ever recorded, and the record low sea ice in Antarctica, and a 5-day polluting oil depot fire in Cuba, which has resulted in the death of one firefighter and 17 missing and 121 injured. And the alarming flash floods in Pakistan and Seoul and in Kentucky. Draw near, holy love, enfold us and heal our wounded world. Holy One, divine healer, In our two communities of faith joined together today, united in our calling to be a bearer of your peace and justice as Christ's hands and feet in the world, we lift the names of those who we love, who need your healing and peace in particular today. For Karen and Jill and Daniela and the Redlands UCC Church, for Bernie, for Dick, for Bill, who has entered hospice, for Chris's mom and the Yee Knoll family, and for Celissa's mom. Holy One, source of our hope and strength, guide us together in the work of kingdom building that you call us to each day. Renew us in community for the challenges of following you. And let us join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Creator, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
This morning, as we collect our offerings, we invite the Fullerton congregation to use the wood plate and the Brea congregation to use the metal plate. And although our plates may be separate, the love and gifts we offer to our faith communities are one in the spirit of the living God. Reverend Howard Thurman, mystic and scholar, speaks of faith as keeping alive the dream, saying, "For as long as a person has a dream in their heart, they cannot lose the significance of living." Let us keep dreams of thriving alive for ourselves and one another by gathering our shared resources this day. I invite our ushers to come forward to collect our gifts and our offerings.
Let us stand for the song of dedication.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication. We dedicate our lives and all that we have to the work of life, of love, of peace. Receive our gifts and lead us in wisdom and courage. Amen.
The Congregational Church of Fullerton likes to practice communion every week, and so sometimes when we joint worship together, you at the Brea Congregational Church end up having communion on not the first Sunday of the month. And so today we will be practicing communion together, and communion is God's table, and it is open to all people. And it is accessible in multiple different ways. I have my notes with me today. They're in your bulletin. You can use the prepackaged elements that were available next to the bulletins in the narthex and stay in your seat. You can come forward and take a piece of bread and dip it in the cup. And as is Brea's tradition, there is a cup with a ribbon that has wine and a cup without a ribbon that has grape juice. Or you may come forward and take a piece of bread, and there will be individual cups that you can partake from also. As we gather at this communion table, we remember that God calls us here. God calls us into community, and this is God's gift to all of us. No matter who we are, no matter why we're here this morning, or where we've come from, we are welcome at this table of love and peace that seeks to make us whole. We remember that on the night when he was about to be betrayed, Jesus took bread and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he blessed it and gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Holy One, be present at this meal. Be present in and through these elements that join us together in a table, in a meal. Whether we are strangers or close friends, you bring us together here. May we be filled with your love and your peace. Amen. The table is ready and you are welcome.
And now let us all rise together. If you are able, let us sing our closing hymn found in your hymnal, number 499, In All Our Living.
Please join me in the commission and blessing. We go from this place not alone, but among a cloud of witnesses, blessed by the wisdom of the elders and led by the dreams of the young. Let us co-create resurrection this day and always. Amen.
May the loving Spirit of God go before you to guide you, beside you to guard you, beneath you to uphold you, above you to bless you, and behind you to forgive you both now and forevermore. Amen, and go in peace.